Hey, everybody. Welcome back to the ATR podcast, All Things Rangers. And we got a lot always. We always have a lot to break down because we always have 2 hours of conversation that we have to go with. All right. I am, of course, your host, Mark Williams, and I'm joined by the one and only Mr. John Vilkowski.
Give me October, please. Give me October.
And of course, as always, if I hadn't said it before, because last week he came back, but it's great to have him back in North America again, Mr. Anthony Larocco.
Well, to play off what John said, I'll do a little little Green Day and wake me up when September ends. Let's go. Start season.
Absolutely. Come on. And we all know one thing that once the season starts, we can stop with idiotic rumors, because when it comes to that, I present to you. Oh, by the way, before I get started, I owe someone a public apology. The other day, I referred to In the Mouth of Madness being directed by Clive Barker, and it was John Carpenter. I should have known, because he's much better than that hack Clive Barker is. So I give you In the Eichel of Madness.
I'm not going anywhere. I'm God now, you understand? But maybe I can help you believe. Look around when you wake up. Did I ever tell you my favorite color was blue?
Relax, buddy. Relax. You're awake now.
It was just a bad dream.
I think I can now officially say I featured Sam Neill more than I featured any other actor on here, because he was also...
I couldn't see anything on that from the video.
Oh, you didn't? Fortunately, it's in the in the comments section. But as usual with the Rangers, Jack Eichel trade rumors are dominating. John and I did a small show. Well, small compared to what John usually does. The other night, and yes, it was after my golf outing, so I had a little bit in me, so my apologies. But again, it's dealing with Carpinello's tweet about Mika Zibanejad being involved while he's got a no-trade clause. There's always a different Eichel rumor every single day. When are we going to hear the end of this, John?
As Chris Johnson said, next pressure point is training camp. If he's not dealt by then, I'm not really sure at that point. But it's become too much. Kevin Adams is now dragging him through the mud, and it's become personal, as some of the other commenters said the other night. And it just needs to end. It needs to end for both sides. I don't get what Kevin Adams gains by doing this. I mean, the return on him is going to be lesser and lesser each day. I mean, teams are going to be, you know, less willing to take him on. And I don't see where the end game is anymore. You're heading, like I said, to the same point that Eric Lindros and the Flyers got to 20 years ago. And they could have gotten so much more for him had they had traded him earlier on. And they didn't, and they took a hit on it. Thankfully for them, Kim Johnson became a good player, and that ended up biting the Rangers in the ass. But you know what? If Adams wants to do this, and the Pegulas are going to sit there and trust every word he says, and they're going to live by his actions, then the Pegulas deserve to have a shitty team on the ice. Because when you put your faith in someone like that, and he continues to do things like this and embarrass himself in the organization, then you know what? You deserve it. So I feel bad for the fans. the ones with the realistic, unrealistic asks who think they're getting the 1992 Eric Lindros trade return. That's not happening. It wasn't happening when he was healthy. It's not happening now. And if it was going to happen, a deal would have been made already. So at this point, I just want it to end. Even if he's not a Ranger, I'm tired of it. I really am.
It's one of those things I can't help but point out and say, because I was talking with Dean about this in our comment section. He could take a B deal. He doesn't have to get Kakko, or Lafreniere, or Kratzoff, or Lundqvist, or Schneider. The B deal would still be Chytil. You can get, forgive me for saying his name wrong, Pujiniemi.
Yeah, Lori Pujiniemi.
Thank you. Matthew Robinson and two draft picks and a conditional one at that. And that's five players right there. That's easy. And now you just got back a 30-year team. But instead, what he's going to do is he's going to hold out. And like I said, I used the poker analogy before. He already has all the cards are out. Everybody knows what's there. There's no surprises. So it's like you're trying to bluff on the river, and we already turned over the cards. So just it's getting even worse. And Sticks and Cricks just said, how was he embarrassing? Yeah. I mean, it's just getting embarrassing because the situation is just getting out there. So I don't know.
Eichel doesn't get traded. Yeah, he actually kind of does, because you have an asset that is depreciating in value, and he's never going to play for your team again. And he has a no movement clause that kicks in less than a year. So if you don't trade him now or sooner than later, he controls where he goes, and then you take an even lesser return. So
yeah,
I don't understand how people don't get this, but
I'm happy. Yep. Anthony, your thought on that?
Well, I think there's a couple of contributing factors here. First off, I'll say I don't think he's being traded before training camp. I think time you can realistically see him get traded is when training camp opens. So I don't think you're going to see a trade between now and then. But the reason why he still hasn't been traded is there's two things here. One, obviously the ask from Kevin Adams is high. And two, you know, you're talking about a player that, regardless if you're talking the fusion surgery or the artificial disc replacement, it's a player that's going to need a, you know, relatively serious surgery. And teams obviously are skeptical about giving up the farm for a guy who needs a surgery, may not be ready on time. So when you take those two factors and you combine them together, it leaves you at a stalemate. Kevin Adams doesn't want to budge on his price, and you know, it's just what it is. And I see his point of it from his side. You know, Eichel was the cornerstone of their franchise. He's an elite player, and he doesn't want to give up, you know, anything less than a really stellar return for him. So I get that, but at the same time, has to come a point where you need to come to some sort of compromise and make the best available deal. But, you know, to him, guys like, you know, maybe Filip Chytil or Kevin Fiala aren't good enough for a centerpiece of a package of Eichel's caliber. And you know what? I kind of agree with that. I mean, if I were a general manager, I wouldn't want to give up Jack Eichel for players like that. But it could be the reality of what he's facing right now. I mean, we'll see. The other thing is, and it's a big gamble, is he hoping that Eichel, you know, plays for the Sabres actually this year, comes back from whatever procedure he gets, plays at a really high level, teams see that he's healthy, and now they get a little more. It's a risk, but it's something that he could be thinking right now, and it could lead to why he hasn't been traded yet. So,
but every single suitor,
I'm tired of it too.
Every single suitor's falling out. Every one of them.
So they say.
LA is gone. Anaheim wants nothing to do with it because they're not giving up Zegras or Drysdale. Minnesota has basically screwed themselves with the cap. I mean, how are they pulling that off now at this point? You can talk about this season, but the next year, the year after, and the year after that, there's $12 to $14 million of dead cap on their books. So they're out. Unless you want to try to squeeze an upwards of 15 players with about $20 million of cap to work with, considering that they still have to re-sign Kaprizov, and they're going to have to give him close to what Eichel's making. So, I mean, I don't understand how you – obviously, one of two things is going on there with Kaprizov. He's either using that as leverage to get Minnesota to get him that kind of deal, somewhere close to a $10 million range deal, which is what the supposed asking price from his camp was about like a month ago that came out. They were looking for about $9 million. Or he's trying to get the hell out of Minnesota. So, I mean, Minnesota has their own problems to deal with, and I don't understand how they'd even be in on him anymore. Maybe they are, maybe they aren't. But
if they're in on him, it's because you'd want Eichel to be with Kaprizov. Yes. You're not going to deal Kaprizov for him. Although that is, we're going to talk about Kaprizov more on the show later. And it's just, there's a couple different things just to mention from the comments. And by the way, this is another metaphor I used just last night. If you got a BMW, and it's worked, it's in great shape, but it recently needs work. Like, I don't know, fixing the whole crankshaft. Because that's what your neck is. It's basically the spine. And you're going, all right, well, one mechanic says it's good, and it just needs the drive to be better. I'm trying to make a reaction. And, yeah, it's just, and are you going to actually, like, pay top dollar for it? Of course not. The car needs work. You have to put work into the car. And every single day that Eichel says, I want this surgery, and he's going to be out for 2 months, and then he's going to have at least a month of conditioning and rehab. The price goes down. And by the way, a no move clause does mean he gets to dictate where he goes, because he's not going to go to anywhere.
This sticks and I just doesn't get it. He doesn't get it at all. And I don't understand how you don't get it. No movement clause is a lie. Then on top of that, if he holds out, he's not playing for the Sabres again. Bridges burned. So he's not going to play for them. And if he holds out, then Buffalo has an asset that's sitting on the side. So, yes, he does have a say in it, whether you like that or not. Look at Eric Lindros. Look at Alexis Yashin. Holdouts, the players always win in holdouts. That's how it is, whether you like it or not.
Anthony.
That doesn't really work out for anybody, though. I mean, even if he pulled out Alexis Yashin and he missed a year, that doesn't do any good for him, not playing for a year, and it doesn't do anything good for Buffalo. So, I that would be dumb on Eichel, personally, to say that he's not going to report to Buffalo and he's going to hold out, because in the end, it doesn't do anything for him. So, I don't know. I think hopefully it doesn't come to that and ends before training camp, but I'm not so certain anymore.
John, you okay up there?
No, they don't have to accept the trade. Just get it.
All right, well, we'll go on that. Well, I mean, because I got to move on from this, because we do have some positive stuff to talk about, because Igor Shesterkin signed a 4-year deal. Are you guys a little surprised it's only 4 years?
I mean, the cost of locking up to a longer term deal, like, you know, 6-7 deals, would have ate up more years of UFA, and maybe the Rangers would have had to have paid for that. So I think 4 years was a way to, you know, keep the cost down for them, which typically, though, longer term means less money. But in this case, it's also talking about cutting into prominent years of a guy that could be an unrestricted free agent. So, but, you know, I thought a 4-year deal, 4-year deal is fair. I mean, let's face it, Shesterkin is a guy capable of, you know, posting like a 930 save percentage. Last year, what do you have, like 916? So for him, I guess that's on the lower side, and you know, maybe the Rangers didn't want to commit a whole ton of years and a whole ton of dollars until they see more of a sample size. So I think 4 years is fair for both sides, though, honestly. It's fair for the Rangers. They can really see what he's going to be over these 4 years, and it gives Shesterkin some, you know, some control as well. So I think it's a fair deal for both sides.
I actually love this deal. Oh, by the way, John, you're crystal clear. I got you right now. But I love this deal so far. It's, I mean, the AAV is a little bit high, but you know what? It's, that's the way the contracts were going. And it's, they could have ended up paying him more. I think his upside is tremendous. The only question I have is his health. And I hope he's going to be healthy throughout this entire contract. And Igor's our number one. Let's not pretend he's not. We've been waiting for him for years. He's the number one. That's just pay him. We don't want him going anywhere. And he doesn't want to go anywhere. He actually didn't even file for arbitration. That's how confident he was on this. Avoiding bridge deals is a positive. That's right, AZ. That is where JG failed with Booch. Jury would have had a greater return if Booch was not on a bridge deal. No, he would have had a greater return if Booch was actually signed. That's the reason why. Because once they have to go, that they got to go do and sign him. Eventually, I think Georgiev is going to get moved. So, and I agree with this one with Justin that he played on a weak team. Would you rather pay the same amount? No, again, I'd rather pay our guy. We know that's our guy. That's the thing. So, I was waiting for John's input on that, and I think he's coming back on in a moment. But
I think the Rangers, regarding Georgiev, I think the Rangers missed the boat to trade Georgiev. I think they should have done it a good year and a half ago. He wasn't very good last year. Let's be real. I don't know what his trade value is right now, but I don't think it's very high. So they might as well hold on to him, because if you move him, what's the other the goalie options left? Let's face it, suck. So if you trade Georgiev, now what? You're either signing some sort of reclamation project, bringing up a kid from Hartford, or what? Signing Lundqvist again? I mean, who knows?
That's not happening.
He posted an Instagram photo the other day, like him like strapping on his pads. So, you know, I know he's probably working back and getting cleared, but. So, yeah, the options, if you trade Georgiev, aren't very good. So they might as well keep Georgiev, hope he has a respectable year, and then maybe look to move him, you know, next offseason. But
it's, you know, I thought they could have traded Georgiev and gotten back Kevin LeBanc a year ago. But, you know, Georgiev was okay. He wasn't great last year. But, yeah, he might be cementing himself as a backup, even though there's spots that are open. Buffalo right now, for instance, doesn't have a goaltender. So Rangers are going to have a log jam soon in their goaltending area because Tyler Wall's knocking on the door.
Craig Anderson and Aaron Dell are in Buffalo, but AKA tanking for Shane Wright.
Yeah, and there's going to be a lot of that. All right, so what do you think about the Shesterkin deal, and how do you feel being surrounded by Jack Eichel rumors all the time? Are you left there screaming, much like I am in the intro? So put it all down in the comments below.
If you like that video, we got a lot more. So check out any of these that are right over here. And don't forget to like, share, and subscribe.
Your ideas are intriguing to me, and I wish to subscribe to your newsletter.